I used to start my intervention with a so-called Celtic stone, but because of this salt crisis, it was for me a godsend. I tried to find a Celtic stone myself, and I have about 100 of them. And I show you one big one. Look. Normally a stone behaves like this, but the Celtic stone, so-called Celtic stone, does this. We call that a surprising observation. Serendipity always starts with a surprising observation. But I found a stone who behaves like that. Can you see it well now? So with the clock, it does this. It returns, and after that, it returns a second time. And when I turn it against the clock, it also returns, and then it returns again. So the first one who wrote about this so-called Celtic stone, or Celt, was Meneer Walker in the Journal of Applied Mathematics from Cambridge in 1895. And he does not give a source of the Celt. He only said he borrowed a Celt from somebody. And it is always told that the Celts, that this was found by archaeologists interested in Celtic artifacts. And I always believed this. But I wanted to find out who did find it, where and when, and I couldn't find it. And then I asked somebody interested in old history, and he checked it for me. And he told me back in the 19th century in Great Britain, it was fashionable to attribute magical things to the Celts, to give it more cachet, to give it a snob appeal, as we say. Snob means sine nobilitate, you know that from Italian. Students, in a long time ago, students used to be from nobility. And when they were not from nobility, they were sine nobilitate. And that was, the acronym was S.Nob, sine nobilitate. That's the word knob. And now we know that it has nothing to do with the Celts. In the museum shops of science museum, it is called a rattleback. Look at this. I made it from lead. It also works in lead. And I should not have checked it, because I did like the idea that we have an example, a physical example, as we call it now, a material example of a surprising observation from the prehistory. But it found out that it's fake. It's still interesting who invented this behavior. Other examples are the so-called slinky. A metallurg was working on these kind of structures, and then it fell from his working table, and he saw that it did walk, and then he said to his wife, Betsy, there is a toy in it. Now it is the official toy of Philadelphia. The same is true for what we call a frisbee. You know this. Students who passed an exam in an American campus, they bought an apple tie, and after eating it, they started to throw the metal bottom of it, which was sharp at the edges, so they said, frisbee, frisbee. And then the Prince of Serendip, he saw a toy in it, and he changed the name in frisbee with double E, and then he patented it. And now it's even a worldwide sport. But the most funny example I have, by the way, you can do the same thing with a spoon. Look at this. If you bend a spoon asymmetrical, you see that it returns also. But with a spoon, you can do a second thing. When you put a little bit of condense on it, you can hang it on your nose. And I'm sure this was discovered by accident, because nobody's going to try whether he can hang a spoon on his nose. And there is a third serendipitous story about a spoon. If you keep your hands like this, and look via a spoon to your hand, you see an erotic scene. You don't need a scanner to make an image of the human coitus. Just a spoon is enough. And what all these examples of serendipity have in common, they all start with surprising observations. I read the fairy tale in, I can't read all Persian, but I asked a Dutch Iranist to translate the fairy tale for me in English and later in Dutch. I also edited it in English. What is interesting is that the Germans, there was a German professor in Munich, Josef Schick. He had the dream to write about all the items, subjects in Hamlet. He called that Corpus Hamleticum, but he died before he ended that study. And two books about what he called Scharfsinnsproben, proofs of sagacity, were only devoted to the sources of that fairy tale. I have one of those books. Next slide, please. No, you go in the wrong direction. I read the English translation very carefully. And if you read between the lines, the text does not write about it. The three princes were, without any doubt, educated and trained in hunting, and also in the art of tracking, that is the art to find and interpret tracks of invisible animals. Now there is a man, Louis Liebenberg, he is teaching in Harvard now, he is from South Africa. And he was a young soldier at the border, the northern border of South Africa, to defend South Africa. And he was annoyed and he asked his boss, he said, can I pass the border? I want to study persistence hunting of the Kalahari. And he did. And he wrote a thesis on it called The Art of Tracking, the Origin of Science. And in his hypothesis is that what we now call the scientific method started as the art of tracking. You see something invisible only by visible traces. X-rays were found this way because they are invisible. Penicillin, what Fleming called penicillin, was discovered this way. And his hypothesis is that the human brains were developed in the direction of good hunters. But the good hunter is able to see an invisible animal via visible signs. And a good researcher can do the same. He can discover invisible phenomena via visible signs. And these signs, these clues were for Carlo Ginzburg, the roots of what he called himself the evidential paradigm. I can't read my own text. It's now called the sign paradigma, the indices paradigma. Ginzburg was a well-known Italian art historian. Next, please. And Walpole was a reader, and he knew the work of Francis Bacon. Francis Bacon, he wrote in Latin. And he was an erudite. And once he read all the Greek tales, mythos, as we say, hoping to find a new light on what we call science. And he was intrigued by the hunt of Pan. Pan was asked by the Greek gods to find Ceres, the goddess of recolt, harvest, because the harvests were bad. But Pan refused to look for Ceres. He preferred real hunting on animals. And hunting animals, he found Ceres. And that example was elaborated by Bacon in exactly the same words that were used by Horace Walpole when he coined the word serendipity. Next, please. So the only originality of Walpole is that he coined a word for the phenomenon described by Bacon, which he read in Latin, by the way. And I know Samantha doesn't like observations, definitions. In Holland, there is a philosophical movement, a significische beweging, the movement of significance. In Holland, we like to agree on what we are talking about before we talk about. As we say in French, pour discuter, il faut être d'accord. People like Eco and Pierce and Merton, they all agree on the scientific definition of observation. Serendipity starts by definition as a surprising observation, fact or relation, followed by a correct abduction. Then you do not need the word luck or chance or azar. That's an old Arab word for a stone to play with. An abduction is what we now call a hypothesis. It comes from the Greek. It is a wrong traduction of apagoge. A retroduction should have been the good translation. In Dutch, we have the word herleiding. And Aristotle himself, he gives a beautiful example. You can, somebody who sees the surprising different faces of the moon, he first has to invent himself, to imagine himself, to suppose himself, to hypothesize himself, that maybe the moon is reflecting sunlight before he can check it. And next one. The next slide, please. And Eco, he was a professor in semantics, that is the science of science, so to say. He distinguished four kinds of abduction. The most easy one is what he calls overcoded. You go from one surprising fact to another fact based on a given rule. Wolpoop, for example, might have discovered that he was a bastard. He looked and behaved like the well-known lover of his mother, which is a strong sign. He was, so to say, the personification of an unsolved finding. In the fairy tale, the original Persian version, there is also discovered that the king, that a king was a bastard. And in Hamlet, there is the same item. That's why it was investigated as a scharfzienproben. An abduction, and then it becomes more interesting, can also be undercoded. Then you go from a surprising fact to a possible rule, like Jenner's vaccination. Jenner wanted to inoculate a milking girl, but she refused. She said, I've had smallpox, and I am immune, as we say now, to human pox. And Jenner was intrigued by this remark. He did not push it away as a fake. He studied it, and he used 25 years to put that observation on the rock, and nobody was able to push it from that rock. When he wanted to publish it in a Royal Society transaction, the article was refused because it was too revolutionary. In France, there was a revolution in the making, and in London, they were afraid for the same. And then Jenner published his classic article himself. He went to a printer as a pamphlet, as it is called now. Then we go to even more interesting abduction. An abduction can be creative. Kandinsky, for example, he was not trained as a painter. He was obliged to become, his father obliged him to become a lawyer. So as an autodidact, he started to paint. And at a certain moment, he came in his atelier and he was flabbergasted by a painting that did not represent a recognizable scene. It appeared to be a painting of himself standing on its side. So that was a surprising observation. That was a discovery. And then he invented that you can make such a thing intentionally. That was the invention. And then he was so creative that he did that himself. And after certain years, he was fed up with it, and he started to paint again figuratively. And he wrote about this himself in 1913. But the most interesting is the so-called meta-abduction. The Newton himself said that he saw an apple falling, and then he asked himself, why does the moon not fall also? And he started to calculate, and then he found out that the moon does fall on the Earth, but in such a way that he does not succeed. The moon does not travel fast enough to disappear in the cosmos, and not slow enough to fall on the moon. as a Frenchman said, il faut être, Paul Valéry said this, il faut être Newton pour apercevoir que la lune tombe quand tout le monde voit bien qu'elle ne tombe pas. A Newton was needed to see that the moon falls when everybody sees that the moon does not fall. Next slide, please. Wendy? Yeah, thank you. A better definition of serendipity is given by Merton. I corresponded with him and I asked him to publish his manuscript, but he didn't. So I asked Umberto Eco to influence Merton to do it. And Merton, Eco did not answer me, but he organized an Italian translation of the manuscript, which was published by Il Mulino, the mill with which you could make paper, the so-called white art. And after that, it was the son of Merton who organized the American version in the Princeton University Press for the Department of Social Sciences. Very interesting. Merton, he gave, in my eyes, the best definition of it. For him, it is a datum that is unanticipated, abnormal and crucial. It can be an enigma, an anomaly, or a novelty. And be careful, the surprising phenomenon can be marginal or even minimal, and at first sight be a triviality. But even trivial things can be crucial. And as everybody will agree, the new and the unknown cannot be extrapolated logically from the old and the known. If that would be possible, it wouldn't be really new. For something really new and unknown, an unpredictable element is needed, a surprising observation or idea. A patent, very interesting in the British patent law, for a patent, a surprise is required, although it may be an unsought finding. Even if an invention's useful properties are discovered by accident, it does not affect its patentability. That is stated explicitly in British law. Reason is logical thinking as taught at school. Intuition is very beautifully defined by A.D. de Groot, the methodologist. Method means meta hodos, Greek for the road which you've taken. Meta is from one village to next village, and hodos is the road. Intuition is to anticipate without being able to make that explicit in prospect or even in retrospect. Serendipity is one step farther. It is by definition unanticipated and beyond intuition. It becomes a kind of intuition in the making. Next, please. The main fields for serendipity are, of course, science, technique, art, and daily life. There are four ways to find something new. You have the non-serendipity. One finds what one searched for without any crucial accident. Yersin, for example, discovered the cause of Black Death. That's why it's called now Yersinia pestis. Because he was, as a pupil of Pasteur, he hypothesized that it was an infection. So he went with a microscope to what we now call Indochina, southeast of Asia. And within 1 week, he had the erreger, the cause of pest. He just put a knife in a little bulb of somebody's death because of pest, and then the puree comes out. He uses that French word. He is French. He is a Swiss speaking French speaking Swiss, and then he finds that animal in it. The pseudo serendipity. It's a horrible word, but the phenomenon is interesting. The word is coined by an American chemist. There is no field in which serendipity is so normal as in chemistry. It can be defined as a salt finding in an unsolved way. Fleming, for example, he was looking for what we now call antibiotics. He did work as a doctor in the First World War, and he knew that when the soldiers were infected at the front, he had no arms to help them. He was armless. And then when he did his classical observations, his comment on it in a French book about him, he said, the spores didn't stand up on the agar and say, I produce an antibiotic, you know. The book is from Morois, translated in English, by the way. positive serendipity, one finds what one did not search. For example, x-rays. X is interesting. It comes from the Arab algebra. The Arab, they had, now it's fashionable to people like Arab bashing. I hate that. The Arabs, they had the originality and the courage to create, to invent and create a sign for the unknown. Sh in Arab. Sh means something. And I see that character is displaced. We are still not very kind with Arab originality. When the translators in Toledo were trying to translate the Arab algebra in Latin, they had no character for sh, but there was just one character left. The big X, the small one was already used. Amal Bey, a. So they use that. That is the first name of the wife of Socrates, which is beautiful in my own. An Arabist told me that we should appreciate the Arabs to have done that, because serendipity is about the unknown, and the Arabs, they had the courage to create a symbol for that, which we now build bridges that do not break. With one exception in Geneva. Then we have the negative serendipity. The surprising observation is done, but not, or not crucially explained, like Columbus. Why did he talk about Indians? Because he believed he had found a way to sail to India. Next, please. Negative serendipity. Yeah, well, this is important. Serendipity is triggered by three totally different kinds of observations. It can be an enigma. An observation is called enigmatic when there is no theory to describe, explain, or predict the observation. Like amber, the Greek word for it is electron, when you rub it on wool, it attracts dust. And the Persian word for amber is brennstein in German, because it burns, is a stone that attracts straw. Then another category of observations are anomalous observations. Then the observation conflicts with theories, which is something else. Nuclear fission, for example, the phenomenon, what we now call nuclear fission, was found when atoms were regarded as unsplittable. And it was a woman, Lise Meitner, she was a woman from the old people, as we say in Holland, from Austria, who had the idea that atoms were unsplittable was wrong. So the dogma had to disappear. Dogma is a Greek word for opinion, instead of epistema, that is a controlled opinion. And then a novelty. In Holland, I always use the bicycle. In more than two centuries ago, there was a volcanic explosion in Indonesia. And there was so much ash in the sky that the harvest was a disaster in Germany. The Germans called about eine Jahre ohne Sommer, a year without a summer. And Baron Dreis, he started, the horses had to be killed because there was not enough food for them. And to replace the horses, Dreis invented constructions with four or three or two wheels. And the one with the two wheels, it was a walking bike, a velocipede. He discovered there was a steer on it to follow the road. He invented, to his big surprise, that he could use the steer to get and stay into balance. And totally unforeseen, and he patented it, of course, and it went to the exhibition, World Exhibition in Paris. And every bicycle, even today, is still an application of that surprising observation of Dreis. In French, it was called the Draisienne. Next one. What I like of the bicycle example is that every child who learns to bicycle has to rediscover, like as Dreis did, that you can use the steel for two different things. I never realized that when I learned to use a bicycle. And next slide. Yeah, this is also something you never learn at the university. In original search, the searcher uses one leg for hypothesis testing. That is what you learn. But the other one, and normally explaining, you don't learn it. You do not learn it, although there are examples enough. Next slide, please. Of course, not every surprise emerges by testing a new hypothesis. The test of a new hypothesis offers not always a surprise. And a surprise gives not always a fresh hypothesis. And a fresh hypothesis emerges not always from a surprise. It's a very rare phenomenon. Therefore, it's important to know enough about it not to miss your surprising observation when you do one. In China, they say that you need a whole human life to do one original observation. And normally, you miss that observation, because it's so unusual, absurd, never heard of. Absurdum in Latin means never heard of. It's well known, that the literature shows that, that an experimenter who tests the hypothesis and observes a surprise normally asks himself, what went wrong? Did I do something wrong? And if so, what? And after excluding an error, he starts another hypothesis till he is there where he wants to go. Next one. Claude Bernard is interesting. His father was a winemaker, and he had first the ambition to become a dramatist. He wrote a text for theater plays, but he was not good enough, so he became a doctor. He was a very mediocre medical student, far below average, and then he became an experimenter. And after inventing what we now, after discovering what we now call glycogen, he talks about substance glycogen. He writes in French. I translated it in English, and he, you can see that he is still a dramatist because it's very well formulated. We must never neglect anything in our observation of facts, and I consider it as an indispensable rule of experimental criticism. Huh? The role of experimenting, never to admit the existence of an unproven source of error in an experiment, and always try to find a reason for the abnormal circumstances that we observe. And then there is a crucial phrase, nothing is accidental, and what seems to us accident is only an unknown fact whose explanation, abduction, may furnish the occasion for a more or less important discovery. Next one.
Heck, just a quick shout out that you have 5 minutes left.
Okay, next one. And this is a most beautiful. The people who got the Nobel Prize, they are free to talk. They are obliged to give acceptance lecture, and they are interesting because there they can say what they want. And one of the co-inventors of what we now call the buckyball, he says everything in one, alinea. In science, conjecture, that means a hypothesis, drives both experiment and theory. For it's only by forming conjectures that we can make the direction of our experiments and theories informed. If such and such is true, I should be able to do this experiment and look for that particular result, or I should be able to do this theoretical formulation. Conversely, experiment and theory drive conjecture. One makes a startling observation, well, that's what I call a surprising observation, or has a sudden insight and begins to speculate on the significance and implications and to draw possible conclusions. However, not all conjectures are equally valid or useful. It's even funny also. Next one. Remember yourself the expression startling observations. Yeah, then the sources. I have hundreds of examples collected in all the languages I can get hand of. You have the fairy tales. Charles Lamb, who was a humorist, and he wrote a beautiful story about the invention of roasted pig. The dissertation on a roast pig, you can find it on the web very easily. It is for me the most funny example from fiction. And often it is referred to as a scientific text. Then Apocryph. Caldi is with his goats. He sees that the goats get wild after eating what we now call coffee beans. And he tells it to an iman. And he says, well, the birds must have picked the breasts of the goats. And Caldi says, I've never seen that. And an iman, he burns the berries and makes an extract and tastes it. And then he cannot sleep. And that is how coffee should have been invented. A beautiful story, because the person doing the original observation is somebody else as the person who systematically analyzes the observation. And then that beautiful phrase of about Newton. Valéry was interested in what we now call the creative process. Then hidden, many publications hide the serendipity. Heparin was discovered by chance, and MacLean, in a phone call more than 40 years after that, he revealed that he discovered it even before becoming a medical student by accident. He was looking for factors that helped to clot blood, and he found one factor by which blood becomes unclottable, but because he wanted to become a medical student, he lied that he was looking for it, but he became anyhow a medical student. Well, I talked about electricity already. Next one. Yeah, the domains, that is very important. In science, one discovers what already existed before, but had not been described, explained, or predicted, like X-rays. Technique is a totally other field. You come on something new, like the bicycle, that did not yet exist before. You should very well distinguish those two. In art, then the whole, what happens is linked very much to a person. It's difficult to imagine yourself as Picasso without thinking about Picasso, who wrote himself. He was not only expressive with paint, but also with ink. Moi, je ne cherche pas, monsieur, je trouve. It's almost a century ago, I realize. In daily life, that's too trivial. I will skip that. Next.
Just to give you, just as a 1 minute warning, Pex, we have enough time to discuss.
No, okay.
There a slide? Would you like me to move to the final slide?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
You do what you want. These are the final one. Yeah, these are important. It's interesting. There is a... at the Sorbonne, there was a historian in art, and he read the manuscript of Pasteur. Pasteur, he was the son of somebody who makes leather from skins. And he became, which for me is very logical, what we now call a biochemist. And when he becomes the dean of the science faculty in Lille, not in Paris, He said in French in his manuscript, dans les chances de l'observation, le hasard favorise que des esprits préparés. In the science of observation, chance favors only some prepared minds. And it was printed as des esprits préparés was printed as les esprits préparés. So you can fight about which text you name serious, the printed or the manuscript version. I prefer the manuscript version. It's very muscled. I translated it this way. It's always referred to wrongly. I corresponded with this historian. He's called M.D. Grimek. He's dead now. But one which is for me much more even also revealing is from Le Prince Renguet, a physicist. He said, someone who finds what he's looking for generally does a good job for a student. Thinking of what he desires, he often neglects science, sometimes minimal, that brings something that differs from the foreseen object. The true observer must know to give attention to signs that will unveil the existence of a phenomenon that he does not expect. In French, it's much more beautiful. And Skinner, a behaviorist, that is a stimulus response model of the human being. The human being is seen as a very militant psychologist from Harvard. He said, when you run into something that's interesting, comma, drop everything else and study it. And I have rephrased that. When you stumble on an enigma, an anomaly or a novelty, invent an optimal abduction explanation and test it. Well, that's it. I wish you a lot of serendipity in your professional work, in your personal life, in your cultural life. It's not only, I think it is intrinsic to the human behavior, like stupidity. It is a post hoc phenomenon. Only afterwards you can find out whether something was serendipitous or not, like stupidity. It's also comic, by the way, because by definition it has a frappe, une tournure. The surprise is crucial on it.